All right, starting over. So I really just want to have a conversation. I'm really passionate about Git and GitHub, tremendous power that it can have. And I just want to bring some information to the table. I want to hear some ideas that you have. We're not really leveraging it in New York State like we could and should. And just want to have that discussion. So I work at the Department of Labor. So I work at the Department of Labor, and I supervise the web development team and the user experience team, and pretty much we just standardize all the front-end development across all of the different back-ends and going for a common look and feel. We bring in about 20 open source libraries, manage all the front-end dependencies. We have one existence of jQuery, and we make sure that when that gets upgraded that you don't have 1.4 running out there somewhere and stuff like that. So that's what we do. We interact with GitHub all the time. We contribute back some changes. As far as accessibility, government has a lot to give to the open source community as far as accessibility goes because we care about it and it's the law. We contributed back other projects too. We haven't been putting our own code out there because there really isn't a process or a policy as far as like the state goes. Senate's really led the way, but I'm looking to have the discussion about what it would take to have a policy so that within reason any agency could do that. I'd like to just raise of hands, just know who you guys are. You look like you're pretty knowledgeable in Git and GitHub, but how many use GitHub on a regular basis? Right, awesome. So you have a GitHub account, forked and contributed back to someone else's project. Okay, really cool. All right, so we can move ahead. And one more. So I just want to tell you a little bit how I feel sometimes. I came up through the web development side and developer ranks, and a lot of times I would feel like I was stuck in a cubicle in a room, just, and tell me if you've been here, just me, my Red Bull, Stack Overflow, and just hacking away at a problem, trying to figure it out. And it was awesome. I was in the zone. It was great. But that same thing was probably happening at 10 different, concurrently, with 10 different people all across our state at different agencies solving the same problem. And if we had been working together, we could have produced 5 times more code, 5 times better quality, 5 times faster, and had a community spirit and just an interaction that we see at the open source community. So I had a conversation with Ben Balter, who is one of the Presidential Innovation Fellows, and he's pushing GitHub at the federal level. And an interesting point he made, he has an entire write-up, I'll give you some links at the end, he massively intelligent write-up about why GitHub is valuable in government. And he said it's not about code sharing. It's not about having a place that we can give our code to other people. He said it's about the idea sharing, and it's not just code. There's government agencies iterating documents on GitHub. It's about putting an idea out there and letting the idea generate and germinate and move forward. Think about the light bulb. Edison did not invent the LED light bulb. He invented the incandescent light bulb. But even then, he wasn't inventing something new. The problem space was we want to have light when the sun goes down. And so first came the candles, then the lanterns, then the incandescent light bulb, then fluorescent, now LED. And it's the idea that moved forward and forward and forward. Now in the past it took years. Now with the collaboration that we can do digitally, it can happen so much quicker. Case in point. Take Chrome. Chrome is probably our favorite browser now. Anybody prefer Firefox? Okay. Chrome is pretty awesome. I toggled to that about a year ago. And Chrome, it didn't start with Chrome. Chrome built on top of WebKit. which was open source. Chrome wrote an awesome V8 JavaScript interpreter. But they didn't stop there. It was an idea, and it kept moving forward. Then what happened? Joyent took V8 Engine, brought it to the server. Now we have Node.js. And how many thousands of Node.js packages are there now? I think like over 90,000. Now out of that springs NPM and a way to manage Node packages, which borrowed ideas from the Ruby Gem system and, you know, Linux and package distribution. So now within like 5 minutes, you can have an entire system ready to go. There's no more downloading. You just jump to the command line, NPM install a few things, and you're set. Then out of NPM comes another tool that, this is pretty amazing, Grunt. Okay, April of this year, Grunt was started. Grunt is a front-end build system based on Node.js. So Grunt starts in April. They already have over 200 plugins, so the amount of time that iteration takes is compressing so rapidly. And so you can see that it's about ideas moving forward. On top of Grunt, there's even more projects and plugins. We've just proof of concept moving to Grunt off of Ant for our client-side builds. And it's just amazing, just bringing in the packages, what Grunt can do. Let's just talk about Git. I prepared some, you know, high-level stuff here. Looks like we don't need to go into that too much. But what is Git? It's free and open source. That's the power of it. And before we even talk about GitHub, we need to realize that because Git is free and open source, it doesn't matter what tool we use to leverage Git. If that tool goes away, we can always fall back to something else. If GitHub tomorrow started charging $1,000 a repo, we could prop up our own Git server. And that's the power of it. Distributed is the new centralized. You can use Git online, offline, local, remote, Mac, Linux, Windows, command line, GUI, private, shared, on a boat, shipwrecked on an island with a solar-powered laptop. It doesn't matter. You can come back and merge in when you get back to dry land. And that's the power of distributed. We have to start evangelizing a distributed version control system, especially with the cloud. It used to be that you wouldn't be able to work on any code unless you came into the private network, you know, plugged in, checked out an item. Oh, wait, somebody else has it locked. You got to go, override or whatever. But distributed brings so much awesome power. So let's look at what GitHub brings to the equation. So GitHub takes Git, brings it to the cloud. So you have all the power distributed in the cloud. You're bringing the centralized to the distributed as an option, not as a necessity. GitHub says, okay, we care about open source. We're doing free, unlimited, public repos. How awesome is it that a company stepped up and did that? Immense cost to them. Now, a benefit also, but immense cost. GitHub brought the one-click forking and pulling. One click, it's in your account. Make a change. One click, pull request. It's back, lined up, ready to be merged right back into the project. That's insanely good for collaboration because it removes all the friction. Look back to CVS days and all the other ways that Linus actually grew tired of that didn't work for code collaboration. And finally, we have GitHub. This is a picture of the Ruby language project. These are all the contributors. This isn't Waterfall. This isn't even Agile. This is Neural. This is just everybody collaborating. Now, there is oversight. You know, you don't pull something in until you vet it. There are those gatekeepers. But sadly, this isn't how we work in government right now. But it can be how we can work. There's so many shared things that we do. And I'll show you some of the things that Canada is actually really rocking it when it comes to the collaboration on a project that has shared value and savings across agencies. But if we go on to, here's Ruby's. Ruby's only been on there since 2011. They have thousands of commits, multitudes of people, 50 or 48 now. They're pulling stuff in as I speak. Pull requests, waiting to merge code right back in. And here's my Twilight fan fiction repo. Just kidding. So what we have to do is we have to take off our our tech hats and realize that Git can now be promoted to people that might not know the command line. That's where the power, that's where the power of Git and GitHub is going to happen. That's where it's going to get its adoption. You're probably here because you have no problem with the command line, but some people, it freaks them out. That's another way that GitHub has stepped up to the plate. They've said, you ever use Tortoise or some of the other Git clients and it gets kind of buggy sometimes? GitHub stepped up to the plate and said, okay, let's make a Mac client, let's make a Linux client. You know what, for these new people, let's not even explain to them that you have to pull before you push. You know, pull, merge, push. They don't need to know that. Let's just give them one button that says sync, because in the end, 95% of the time, that's what you want to do anyway. And so this interface has come to Git that GitHub has brought, that has brought the learning curve way down. Think about JavaScript. How old is JavaScript? But what did it take? It took libraries, that interaction layer, for some of the more novice programmers that, you know, don't, you know, they might not be diving in and, architecting their code the best way it could be, but it took something like jQuery. It took, you know, Prototype, Dojo, all these libraries to bring that interaction layer to the average users, bring them on. I didn't start JavaScript until I dove into jQuery. I tried it. I got frustrated with it. You know, I put all these on-click events in different places. Terribly sad. But then jQuery was my on-ramp into digging deep into JavaScript. And then I got into Node. And so just because someone, we're not going to ruin all the quality of our code by giving some people a good on-ramp. That's what I'm saying. So GitHub Mac, GitHub Windows. So let's talk about GitHub and government. 2009, 6:20. I remember the day well. I was at home on my feed reader, and GitHub blog was in my feed reader, and up pops New York State Senate code on GitHub. And I was just like, wow, this is pretty awesome. And as far as I can see, this is the first instance of a government agency being on GitHub. Now, there may be others, but I haven't been able to find it in my research. So Senate, you guys just led the way. And just hats off to you. You beat out Australia by like 2 weeks. So now between 2009 and 2011, not much happened. I couldn't find anything in my searches of things happening between those 2 years. You were just ahead of your time. In comes 2011, and the UK is like, wow, we need to just jump on GitHub full force. They took their entire web and app development, put it on GitHub. Forget about private repos. It's all public. You know, if their thinking was, if we modularize and, do property files and configs that we don't push, there are no security vulnerabilities here. Let's push this out. They have 61 members operating out of 101 repos right now. I took this screenshot yesterday, and it's so soon since the last commit that there is not even a number of minutes there. And it's so fun just to jump onto the UK site or a GitHub account and just watch what's going on. There's projects in there. They have a great way of prototyping that they use Jekyll and all of their different templates that they could use for prototyping. And if you want to prototype something for it to be merged back into, like the global styles or interaction layer and stuff, you just jump into the prototype folder, create a page in Jekyll, define in your YAML, you know, what you want the attributes of the page to be, what template you want it to use, and bang, they push it right out to Heroku, but, you know, you can push it to GitHub Pages. Great system. I can't wait to adopt it. And just browsing through, a lot of the things that they're doing, we do also, but we're doing it all, you know, multiple times. I thought it'd be a little bit fun to have a little Git battle here. New York State Senate against AlphaGov, which is what UK calls themselves. We'll see who is actually Alpha, and go. Highly scientific algorithm. Oh, nicely done. Cool little GitHub project. C so you're able to get followers and they aren't as easy. There's no more organization follow button.
Like, for instance, I have more points than both of those accounts. And so, but I don't have 100 repos, 60 people committed to them. So I just...
It's not scientific. It weights time very heavily, too.
But for marketing purposes, we'll take the...
Okay. The UK does like competition, as we heard earlier. So 2012, this has been an awesome year for Git and government. If we take a look at the federal agencies, General Services Administration actually has a terms of service now with GitHub so that any federal agency can start up a GitHub account and within the rules of their service start pushing their code up and getting contributions back. They've already seen this year cross-agency collaboration. They've had the first fork and pull request from the public, and it said, fixed typo. But regardless, this is pretty awesome because it's bringing the code to the cloud and the people.
Could you explain this again? So this is the federal government has an agreement with GitHub?
Yes, a terms of service.
So any federal agency will pay him?
Yes. I believe so. I believe that's what that means. So if you go to the GSA site, they will say these are all the companies that you can do business with. For free and public repos, there is no cost, so it's not a procurement issue. So here's a cool little GitHub project that Ben Balter and a friend put up there. Let me go back to that. So this is all the federal agencies and a live feed of what's happening on those agencies. Pretty cool. Next. So this is what I'm really excited about. Canadian government, early this year, they didn't jump right into GitHub. They took the proposition of cloud collaboration, all the different providers, all the different ways that it could be done. They did a legal analysis, risk assessment, and they've shared all their documents with us. And they took it slow, but when they got the go-ahead, this is their web experience toolkit. They took the front end layer of their websites and realized that there would be tremendous cost savings if they build a common front end. Not necessarily a common look and feel, because you can always swap that out with style sheets, but the skeleton, the JavaScript architecture, front end toolkit, and make it abstract enough that any Canadian agency could use it and contribute to it. And they started a project. It was started before they went onto GitHub, but right now they have 73 developers working on a common front end. You know, Drupal theming, you know, that's pretty awesome, but that doesn't span back ends. A common web front end interface does. You can port it to any system. So right now they have 73 developers working on it. Whenever they do a new release, they port it to SharePoint, .NET, WordPress, Drupal. All the back ends that they could have. It doesn't matter if they haven't managed to pull those together yet or standardize. Common look and feel for the citizens. And very well structured. They have governance in place where certain levels of people anybody can fork and commit and do a pull request. Certain pull requests go through content experts. So like they have CSS experts that review any of the CSS that comes through, JavaScript experts, SharePoint expert, WordPress. Okay, so the quality, they're enforcing the quality, and this is project-based, not just agency-based, and the turnaround is tremendous. They've already had other governments outside of Canada start adopting it. There's a couple South American governments that are using the Web Experience Toolkit. So this is unprecedented collaboration across an entire country that's becoming an international collaboration. So very exciting. I think this is where some of the biggest payoff, especially with our clustering of IT, and the phrase that was mentioned earlier that this just really speaks to is maximize resources, optimize outcomes. This can do it. It's not just this project. There's lots of projects that we all do independently that we can start to collaborate on. So future, what is it? It's really up to us, those of us that understand the power of GitHub and Git itself. There are objections. There's going to be questions. Some people see it as just another source control system, but it's, we know it's not that. But it really comes down to how do we talk about it? How do we promote it? How do we move it forward? And I took a lot of my resources that I found, and I really just wanted to try out GitHub Pages and Markdown and Jekyll and responsive design and a whole bunch of things. But I put it all together in a forkable site called GovGit. Gave it a nice short URL, govgit.info. And I'd ask that if you really believe in the possibilities that Git and GitHub brings, that you fork the repo. Grab some links that you might have bookmarked. Enhance it. The entire first page is from Ben Balter's terrific, we could call it even an essay or a dissertation, down to the bottom called Open Source for Government. And in there, he covers every single objection and weighs it out and makes the case that the benefits far outweigh the objections. The next page, getting started with Git, there's going to be a learning curve for a lot of people. And we can't let that become a hindrance. GitHub already has our back with the software. So any good links for the on-ramp and even the deep dive would be great to put up here. Government on GitHub, this is what I found. It's a short list right now. Federal, Senate, you guys are our sole state representation of civic projects, and international. If there's others, just forking at it, please. And I'm sure this will balloon very quickly. And then the last page is in the news. The 2009, things that have happened in 2012, and 2013 I think is really up to us, and we can really make some things happen. So, go back, if we go back one, cancel. So if you, okay. Okay, you're already there, that's fine. You can fork up at the top, or I made a nice little edit button. So if you click edit, it will pass you through to the repo. Let's keep in contact. If you're really interested in that, I'll keep you in the loop. You can hit me up at my GitHub account there, or email me. It's luke.chard@labor.ny.gov. Any way of communication is fine. We'll make it all come together. So I really want to hear from you guys. I'm by no means the expert in Git. I've been on GitHub about a year and a half now. I've been using Git not too much longer than that. So it's new-ish to me, but the power is and the potential is pretty amazing. So, what are you thinking?
So my extensive Git experience goes back to, let's say, 24 hours, right? Yeah, I'm totally subversion until yesterday working on a project.
Let's pass you the microphone. Can you run it over?
Can't hear through this one?
They're trying to get it on the recording.
Oh. So yeah, working with Graylin over here yesterday, he introduced me to GitHub. My question is, so is the unique thing about Git itself is that you can track the changes of in every version of the project, of your project, from your own local repository on your machine, isolated.
Right. When you clone the repository, you have everything that's ever changed. And even if you never merge back, You have the entire history. If you merge back, even after there's been other forks,
okay.
The SHA on each commit can be mapped back, and it can be smushed back together. It's like pulling a banana apart and being able to just put it back together.
Okay. So the only real caveat to having this is just that you have a larger file on your system as opposed to something like centralized. Separated.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
How do you feel about self-hosted versus GitHub-hosted Git accounts and how they apply to government? Do you think that it hurts the openness of the project if it's self-hosted and private? I guess that answers the question. If it's self-hosted in public and not on a common repository, is that a hindrance to Git's ideology?
Right. If you're looking at the distributed nature of Git and the power that it brings, you don't need to be up anywhere in the cloud. with the UK. I would have never discovered some of their cool projects that they're working on had they not just pushed it up, not knowing that I would be interested. So the discoverability, you lose that when you go self-hosted. If there's any way of us taking our projects and making, you know, pulling out any sensitive information, apart from Department of Defense, is there really anything we do that can't be made public? So why not just push it out? I don't know if it's a why question. It might be a why not.
It was more of a why. It was more of a why not.
Yeah. I would say why not. But I'd love to hear other thoughts. I'm not the expert here.
So there is also, in addition to government directly, there is also government contractors, which in many cases are actually doing work for the government, and many of this work should be going to the public. We have found that there are some either misinformation or fear about how much federal employees should help contractors where they are working in a project. And it's a weird kind of fear that arises from probably misuse of previous projects. The result is that they are timid about collaboration. Have you found that to be the case, and does that apply at all for state agencies?
Right. I don't have the experience of collaborating at a government level. I've had some conversations with a gentleman from Ottawa who's involved in the Web Experience Toolkit project, and the governance they have set up where they have certain gatekeepers, certain knowledge experts, that keeps nothing wrong with denying a pull request or just saying, you know, this is not a bug, this is a feature. So I think governance is going to play a key role that we're going to have to look at in government, that maybe, you know, open source projects might not. But look at most open source projects. The best system that works is a benevolent dictator that you know, does keep things on track.
So to Luisa's question, at the Senate, one of our largest projects is our Bluebird CRM, which is based on Civi CRM, which is an open source project. And it's a huge open source project. And going into it, of course, when we first started with it, we had almost no knowledge on the project at all. We found a local consultant, and we've been working with the local consultant ever since. So we actually have I don't know if it's the same scenario you're talking about. I know some state agencies have, you know, hordes of consultants, you know, working alongside programmers. In this case, you know, we have really, it's a single person, a single consultant, but he has full, you know, commit, you know, push-pull access to our repo, and in fact, he's tied into the core team of Civi CRM, so he's effectively part of that core team that's developing the main application that we use. It's an open source application, and we use it within our own CRM. And that core team, we've given all of them push and pull access to our repo. We fully trust them, of course, you know, because you have you effectively have an audit log of everything that's happening. So if for some reason, you know, one of these people in the core team was, you know, malicious, that would not happen. But if it were to happen, you know, it's very easy to back those changes out. But it's been, I think the relationship we have is fantastic. You know, we now, you know, we're using their product, but we're also, as the Senate, we're contributing back to that open source project. And in doing so, you know, now we're part of that project's ecosystem. And so it just makes sense to have them have that kind of access to our repo. And it's been very beneficial on both sides. I don't know if that answers the question.
It's helpful. My initial concern is more in the other direction. So what I observe more of an obstacle is from the government side going into the open. And maybe it's just the particular experience I have with some federal agencies. But so they are more fearful of, am I going to get in trouble because I'm a federal employee and I'm pushing this code into a GitHub repository and nobody had given me permission to do it. Now there are the spectrum from people who just think that it's plain illegal to do it to others who just say, they just do it and don't ask for permission and we'll ask for forgiveness. But so I guess it would be useful if at some point somebody in the federal government would write a memo saying, this is okay, this is not okay, mm-hmm. and build clarity on what government employees can do.
Right.
It will be very helpful.
Take a look at Ben Balter's write-up. He does cover some of that. He says everyone wins if it's a financial concern where government dollars are funding an open source project, and then there's a for-profit company tied to the open source project that could benefit from it. You know, there could be conflicts of interest there. But in the end, if let's look at all the value we've saved by our use of open source, contributing back, even if some of our hours and manpower does enhance an open source project, we're still on the winning end.
I totally agree with you.
Right.
My point is, it would be great if, for example, the office of the CTO will write a memo saying that.
That's what we need. Yeah, we need that terms of service with GitHub, but then even how we should operate in pushing. Anything else?
So a lot of the benefit of, I guess it's more a comment too, but one of the things that we do a lot with our student development at least is there are a lot of nice side effects of keeping your code in a revision control system. We use a piece of software called Gorce. It's spelled G-O-U-R-C-E. That does visualization of the code repository. So you can see little avatars zooming around and, you know, basically shooting lasers at these little bubbles and lines. It's very flashy, it's very pretty, and it also makes it so that non-developers and non-coders can see the magnitude, the frequency, the amount of work and effort that goes into developing this kind of code. So it's a great analytical tool for us after the fact to then produce and show to folks who want to follow up with our research, different advisors that we have at the university, is something we can use to make the case for this kind of development when you're talking with non-digital natives about the type of effort. So there are a lot of nice side effects besides just being a great way to collaborate.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to Remy's presentation because pushing code to the cloud on GitHub removes the geographical barrier from interns, from working with colleges. It doesn't matter where you are, and that's tremendously powerful. Just about two. All right. Thanks. Love to chat further.
Too, yeah. I have a question. And you might not have looked into it, but do you know how the like, for instance, the WET project, how they do, like, issue tracking and things like that? Because, you know, it hasn't showed up so much in our projects because we haven't had any, not significant, public collaboration on our Senate projects. But one of the things that I can easily see us running into is that we have our own internal issue trackers, and those aren't hooked into publicly accessible GitHub issue trackers. Because some of the issues probably should not necessarily be made public.
Right. Yeah. Some kind of mapping between the public issue tracking.
But so you wind up in this situation where the source code's up there, and maybe you can see the activity that's coming out of it, but other people that you may be wanting to collaborate with don't have access to the motivation behind that. And so I just, when I think about Git and government and other entities like that, it seems like that's sort of a blocker to that working out well. And again, we haven't run into it so much yet because are the few people outside the Senate that we do have collaborating with us, we were able to give them access to everything regarding our internal project. But in a big open source project, someone might be working on one part of one feature, and just because you want them to be able to see some of the issues related to that, you can't share everything. And
yes.
So if they're, I know you said in the beginning that publishing to GitHub isn't isn't just about collaboration and things like that, that there are a lot of other benefits, but if that benefit is going to come into it, then it seems like there's going to be a lot of contention on that side of things. So I just wanted to bring that up and see if anyone had comments or thoughts on that.
Great point.
Well, just looking at this page right here, you said that you did give some outside people access to the bug tracker. For people who do spend a lot of time working on other projects, you can see that activity on GitHub. And in some sense, that can generate some sort of trust that maybe you can use this kind of social coding tool to determine who's trustworthy enough to gain access to your bug tracker and stuff like that. So the kind of community part of it can...
But it's a little different for us because our contributors are actually like hired contractors, but when there's not a already established relationship, let's say Remy decided that he wanted to work on open legislation projects, and we needed to get him access to our issue tracker, that'd be a lot more... Be a lot more involved with that because we don't have an existing formal relationship with them as the same.
Right. So. I think it's case by case. Civic coders are not flocking to contribute to projects except in cases like a hackathon and things like that. So I think just like was said this morning, you can either figure it all out and then go, or you can go and then figure it out when the problems arise. We need to probably lean toward the second, but definitely valid and good concerns.
And just in particular, I bring it up because we have all our projects and they're in our internal issue management stuff. But then we've also got this J Geocoder project that we worked on a little bit yesterday at the hackathon, and that we have had interest from other people in the outside community and working on and contributing to and stuff. And, this is obviously an issue that we need to resolve at some point. But if we do all of our work on it, on our internal tracker, then there's going to be a huge disconnect there. So maybe we move all of our work on that project to the external tracker, but now our projects are, have stuff in two different places. And it sort of splinters things. So I don't know. I think there could be space in this for some sort of GitHub plugin that syncs things between issue trackers and stuff. Might be useful. But that was just me thinking too far ahead, I guess. We're not even on GitHub yet for most of us, so.
Remy has a question.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure that the GitHub issue tracker has like an RSS feed. That you can subscribe to?
It does have tools that you can use to build plugins.
Sure. So like, I mean, my suggestion, it is kind of like doubling work, but parity between public and private issue trackers is probably a good middle ground where you share the tickets you can. And, because the more places you have it existing, the better anyway. I mean, as long as it doesn't require you to maintain like 5 different instances of an issue tracker, but...
Mm-hmm. You already show a little bit of this in GovKit, but so using GitHub beyond code, like documents or other things, recently GitHub allows you to actually create websites, and this is one example of those. This is a very interesting aspect of interacting and making a powerful use of the tool. Clay Cherky was recently showing GitHub as well at TED, and he was making the point that if this tool is shown to other people, for example, lawyers and economists, they will be able to figure out better ways or new ways to use it beyond the coding.
Right. If we look at overview here, if you go down to Okay, Ben Volker's site here. He doesn't link right through to GitHub. You know, the normal fork button. There's another layer, a human-friendly editing layer that will come up. It looks just like a word processor. So if you make a change here, GitHub is in the background, and this is that interaction layer for the general public, and it looks just like a word processor. You make an edit, say save, and then it goes back to him as a pull request.
Did he implement it?
No, it's the site is Prosio, Prose.io. Very interesting. It's bringing like text-based collaboration where people don't even have to understand that GitHub is behind the scenes. Yeah. All right. Thank you.